We love Macon County. We want to show our community that they are known and loved by Jesus. That's why we are so excited about Make Waves VBS this summer.
Just like the ripple effect, we know that what you do today can change the world around you.
When we open up our building, our calendars, and our wallets for kingdom purposes like VBS, we will be blown away by the stories and the waves of love that will flood over Decatur.
Before we can show the kids how they can make waves, we need volunteers willing to step up and make some waves right here on June 20th through 24th.
Whoever you are, whatever age or job you have, you are needed so we can reach our dream of inviting every child in the 42,000 households of Macon County to come experience Jesus' love. To learn more about the serving opportunities for every type of person, follow the link.
Well, welcome home, church. Thank you. It is good to be here. It is good to be worshiping alongside of you all today. And, today we are continuing on in the series called Behold. For those of you that don't know me, and I pray that there are folks here that don't know me, because that means we're bringing in visitors, bringing in guests, and that's our prayer, right? So we're bringing more people in here today. My name is Bill Grinninger, and I'm a pastor of youth and family ministry here. Before we get started in worship, I would just encourage you to stand on up, to shake a hand, to share a name, to tell someone that you are glad that they are here. If you see someone worshiping solo, you go ahead and invite them to worship alongside of you guys. We begin today in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, be in this place. Fill our hearts and our lives with your worship. Lord, we pray that you would not allow us to leave here unchanged, but use this time to mold us, to shape us into who you long for us to be. We pray this in your mighty and precious name. Amen. Amen. Let's worship.
Church, it's so good to see you this morning. Whether you're here in person or online, won't you just worship with us this morning?
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believed in signs and wonders. Resurrection power, yes I do. Still a miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. My
we wrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony. From death to life. 'Cause grace we wrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony.
So kind to me.
it is true. We don't deserve your love. We're thankful that you give it to us anyway, but we don't. God, we've broken your commandments. We've failed at what you've told us to do. We've not loved as we should have, and we've sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. God, we recognize today that your love truly is reckless. That you would live and die for us sinners is incredible. It's more than incredible, but Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we come before you today and we offer all of our sin and our shame at the foot of your cross. Lord, we ask that you would forgive us. You know, we were sitting in Sunday school earlier, and one of the kids was talking about worship, and they were saying that worship is a lot like this, the opening up of hands, and that hit me. Worship really is, and this moment of confession is a lot like this, where we take all of the sin and the shame and the guilt that we've been holding on to, and we open up our hands and we give it over to God. But he doesn't just leave us empty-handed. Instead, he replaces that sin and that shame with forgiveness and grace and mercy and favor. And so I would just invite you to stick out your hands and to open them up and to receive the forgiveness that God has to offer. It is because of the life and death and resurrection of our King Jesus that I can announce to you today, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You all may be seated. You know, sometimes it's nice to hear, and it's good to hear that we are forgiven, but there are other times that we need to experience the forgiveness of God through taste, through smell, through touch. And God knows this, and so he gives to us a supper. And we hear that on the night on which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Church, we believe that God's very body and blood is truly present with the bread and the wine, and that it offers us forgiveness, that as sure as we taste the wine and we feel the bread on our lips, it is the very forgiveness of God being offered to us. If that's your confession, and if you believe you need that forgiveness, I would invite you to come forward and to receive the Lord's Supper. Welcome to the Lord's table.
Confess, bowing here
temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Receive this blessing from our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. May this true body and his blood, may it strengthen you and preserve you, keep you strong in the faith until life everlasting. Go in his joy and in his peace. Hey, I would invite you to stand as we go before our Lord in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, you are good, and we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you have brought your word into this place. We thank you that you are working in our homes and in our marriages. God, we thank you for the 46th wedding anniversary of Richard and Joan Schneider, and we thank you for the 51st wedding anniversary of Gary and Natalie Bernard, and we pray that you would continue to bless those couples, that they would grow closer to you and closer towards one another, that they would seek after you, and that when people see the love that they have for one another, that they would see the love that you have for them. Jesus, we thank you for answered prayers, and we thank you that Kathy Winter is celebrating that her tests show no signs of cancer. We thank you for you healing her. And Jesus, we thank you for the life that you give through the waters of baptism, and we pray for Ella Vanderventer as she becomes a child of God today. Heal her and grow her in your word. Jesus, we do pray for healing for those who need your healing. We lift up Karen and Madeline and Jerry and Sally and Deborah and Clint. We pray that you would bring your loving arms around them, that they would know that you are good and that you are God and that you are surrounding them. Lord, bring healing. And Lord, we lift up those who are suffering loss. We pray for the family and friends of Tim McGrath as they mourn his loss, and we pray that you would bring healing to them. Allow them to know that you are right there alongside of them, that they are not alone as they mourn. And Lord, we pray that you would bring healing in their lives. We lift up all of these things to you, knowing that there's so many more things we need prayer for. We trust all of those things into your hands. And we pray the prayer that you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Heard Jesus called the Lord before. The Bible says things like, taste and see that the Lord is good, and Jesus is Lord of all, and one Lord, one faith, one baptism. But do we really know what it means when we say that Jesus is the Lord? Let me try to help. You may be familiar with Lord Farquaad from the movie Shrek. You know, this guy. In Shrek, Lord Farquaad is the guy in charge of Dublok. In the movie, Lord Farquaad is mean and super short. While not all lords are short and mean like Lord Farquaad, all lords do have power and authority. Like Lord Archbishop of Canterbury, who is one of the highest ranking men in England. Our Lord Jesus Christ is greater than any lord on earth. Jesus has all power and authority. Jesus Christ, Lord Jesus, is in charge of all heaven and earth. Jesus isn't just Lord of Dublok or of Canterbury. Jesus Christ is Lord of all. See ya.
Well, you all are in luck today, because you get in-person announcements. Yeah, can I get an amen? Okay, I know, not that exciting. But here we go. We just have one announcement. I'm leaning in here because we've been talking about the hunt, and I told you my big, audacious goal of having 30 neighborhood hunts, and I can tell you we're not there yet. We're 2 weeks away, April 9th, the challenge for you all. is in your neighborhood to host an Easter event, to invite your neighbors to, that they can be a part of that, that you can bless them, and you can form connections more with them, because we believe, we know that it's most often in the midst of relationship that God works to give us opportunities to share about who he is and what he's done in our lives. And we believe that God has placed you where you are for a purpose amongst those other people. So if you've been considering it, it's not too late to sign up to host in your neighborhood or wherever that is that you might want to do that. And here is one other thing. Listen, if you don't have kids in your neighborhood, that's not an excuse. You can still gather people together and have a cookout or have a fire or have, you know, a beer hunt instead of an Easter egg hunt. Get creative, guys. Gather people to enjoy time together, right? Grown-ups like chocolate too, but invite those neighbors to come, to be a part of just having some time to connect. People are longing for connection after these last 2 years, and God can use that as an open door to impact other people's lives for his glory and their benefit. So please consider stepping into this. If you've signed up, you can come to our table later today and get your stuff. We have kits that give you invitations, Easter eggs, other things, resources. We're here to walk alongside you. You don't have to go alone. Gather other people you know to do it together in one of your neighborhoods. But be a part of this. Step in. I know it's a little bit of more of a stretch. It's a little uncomfortable. But if you do it, I promise you, God will bless it. So that's my piece, okay? With that, we're going to move into just this time where we get to meet and behold our God once again. As always, we love that you're here with us. We love to know that you're here with us. So you can fill out a connect card. If you want to give to support the ministry of St. Paul's, you can drop those connect cards and your offerings in the back there, or you can always give online as well. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, as we've been on this journey, just beholding you and who you are, the fullness more of who you are and these instances in your life and ministry that you displayed those things, Lord, I pray that we have been changed by those things and you would continue to change us even today as we come to you. You are Lord, and we surrender ourselves to you in that, but help us to see, Lord, how you are different from all the other ways we think of Lords, that you, at the heart of it, Lord, have come to meet us. And so, Lord, meet us here, grow us, remind us who you are, and remind us of who we are because of what you have done for us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been walking through this Behold series. If you remember back to week one several weeks ago, I talked about that this is kind of a weird word to us, right? We don't walk around saying, behold, behold, hey, behold, right? But we do use this same concept, right? We say, oh, hey, come look at this, right? You got to look at this. And when we do that, we're not just inviting people to see something, but we're inviting them to experience it. And many times we're saying, hey, this is a significant thing. This is an important thing, right? You got to take notice. You got to see this. And the writers of the Gospels, they did this as well. As they're telling the story of what Jesus had done again and again, we see them use this word, behold, look. Look at what Jesus is doing. Look, experience Jesus in his fullness, who he is. And their hope is that through that, as we do that throughout these weeks, through these different instances, these snapshots of Jesus and his life and his ministry, that in experiencing the fullness of who he is, we might be changed and transformed like those that experienced him there in that day, who just by seeing and experiencing Jesus, their lives were changed forever. And so today we continue that, and this week we're beholding Jesus as Lord, as the Lord, that Jesus is the Lord of heaven and earth, that he is the Lord of all. And in digging into, Jesus is revealing here in our scripture today what it means, what sets him apart as Lord versus all the rest. You know, when I think about that word, Lord, I think when we hear that word, Lord, many of us, what we think of is this, right? It's that king, that emperor, that ruler who's dressed extravagantly. He has all these servants here meeting all of his needs, doing all that he commands, what he says goes, right? He has power and strength and might, and this is what a Lord looks like, right? This is what Aladdin knew, right? This is why Aladdin, when he was trying to impersonate a lord, a prince, to win the heart of Princess Jasmine, right? What did he know he needed to do to prove that he was a lord or to impersonate a lord? Well, he needed all kinds of servants, hundreds and hundreds of servants. He needed mighty warriors. He needed to be dressed in the best of the best, because that's how you know someone is a lord, when they are served, when they have power, when they have the best, when people obey their commands. This is what a lord looks like. And even today, though we don't really know as much or understand the concept of a king as much because we don't have that, we still think in many ways of leaders in this way, right? The mark of a leader is that, you know, people listen to them, people do what they say, that people serve them, right? They're mighty and strong. But here in John 13, Jesus comes in and he shows his disciples, he challenges this understanding of what a Lord looks like, and tells them, shows them, reveals to them in a physical, tangible way, an actual experience of what it means for him to be Lord and how that is so different from the way the world looks at a Lord and what a Lord should be. You see, here in John chapter 13, and I'd invite you to take out your Bibles, whether it's one you've brought, whether it's on your device, whether it's a pew Bible, and open up to John 13. But if you recall, John 13 is Jesus is in the upper room with his disciples. It's that Holy Week, right? They're coming to celebrate the Passover meal, this great festival of what God had done to bring a great victory, a mighty win for his people, right? And so they're gathered here in this upper room to celebrate this. And Jesus, as he gathers with his disciples, remember, though, that this is just 4 days after Jesus has ridden in to Jerusalem on this donkey. And as he rides in, the people are cheering him. They're praising him. They're singing Hosanna in the highest. They're waving palms and laying the palms and their coats down. Really what they're doing, what just happened, is as if he is a mighty king, a Lord, who has come back from winning a great victory. That's what this Palm Sunday, this entrance into Jerusalem is happening. And so Jesus' disciples, having just experienced that with Jesus, right? They're thinking, this is their mindset, is, oh yeah, Jesus is coming. He's coming in might, in power, right? The people see him, they recognize him, they see him as this mighty Lord. Oh yeah, he's gonna bring it here. And you know, well, because we're his disciples, we'll get some glory with him, right? But Jesus is coming in power, we're ready, we're good to go. We're gonna see how he is served by all of God's people here. And in the midst of this expectation of what Jesus was gonna be as Lord, what he was about to do, the greatness he was about to unveil, Jesus gathered with his disciples. We hear John chapter 13, verse 3. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going back to God, he rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments and taking a towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Friends, I don't think we understand or grasp fully the shocking nature of what Jesus does here with his disciples. This action that he does declares the reality of who he is as Lord. It defines his lordship. You see, some of you, you might be think feet are gross, and so you think, wow, this is a big deal, right? But this is even more of a big deal than that. In that day, right, people didn't have closed-toed shoes. They walked around in sandals, right? There weren't a whole bunch of paved roads always. It was dusty. It was dirty. And guess what? Their transportation that traveled on that road was not just humans, but it was animals. And you know what animals do after a while. And so what they were stepping in wasn't just dust and dirt, but yeah. And so their feet were dirty, right? And so when they would come into the household, they would, well, you might wash your feet. You would wash your own feet. Or if you had servants, your servant might wash your feet. To wash the feet of someone was either your job or a servant's job. But for the Lord, the master, the teacher, to wash feet? That's ridiculous. That was below him. That was not even honorable for him to do. This is why when Jesus gets to Peter, what does Peter do? He says, Jesus, no. This is not right. This is not the way it's supposed to be. This is not what you're supposed to do as Lord. Lord, let me set you straight. You know, if anybody's going to wash somebody's feet, I should be washing your feet. This is how this works. People serve you because you are Lord, right? He says, no. But Jesus' response to Peter is, Peter, if you don't let me serve you, if you don't open yourself to receive the sacrificial service that I'm going to bring to you, well, then you have no place with me. You're not my disciple. That's to deny who I am as Lord. See what Jesus is showing his disciples here, how he's flipping their idea and understanding of Lord on its head, is that he's saying at the heart of who he is as Lord is not about people serving him, but at the heart of it is that he is sacrificially coming to serve and to give to them what they desperately need. That Jesus' lordship is not defined by what you and I do for him so much as it's defined by what he has done for you. Jesus' lordship is defined by what he has done for you. And this is important for you and I to hear, to fully grasp. Because I gotta admit, I don't know about you, but many times I'm like Peter, right? Lord, no. This isn't the way it's supposed to be. I don't deserve you to serve me. It's supposed to be me serving you. I couldn't possibly accept that, Lord. I couldn't possibly receive that. But you know, to that, as we look at this instance here, right? If you believe that you don't deserve the sacrificial love and service of our God, just look here. Not only was it the 11 disciples that hours later would run away and abandon Jesus that were there, that he was serving in this radical way, but it was also Judas, the betrayer. He was there in that room. And even though Jesus knew that, what he was about to do, Jesus still served him. That whether they deserved it or not, Jesus served them in this radical way because he knew that what he was about to do, the even greater event of serving and giving of himself and sacrificing of himself, that is exactly what they needed, even if they didn't deserve it. You know, other times it can be easy for us when we think of Jesus as Lord to focus on what we need to do for him, right? Jesus, look at all that I've done for you. That shows you as Lord in my life. Lord, look at all that I've done. Look at what I need to do because you are Lord. But Jesus says here what he communicates to his disciples and to you and me, that recognizing him as Lord, it starts with, at the heart of it is just receiving from him what he has done for us, his sacrificial service to us. Jesus gets at this actually earlier in his journey with his disciples. This isn't the first time he's tried to communicate this to them. Back in Mark chapter 10, a couple of his disciples are so bold as to ask Jesus for this special spot as his like right-hand and left-hand man, right? Hey, Jesus, you know, when you're big and famous and you're the Lord and mighty, can we have the next highest level rank beside you? And of course, the other disciples don't like that. There's a big argument, and Jesus stops them and says, guys, you're looking at the wrong things. This isn't how you're supposed to act. You're not supposed to be about having the power and the might and the fame. Because look at me. Even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus declares, what sets me apart as Lord, what defines who I am as Lord, and if you're going to recognize me as Lord, what you have to receive is this radical service that I'm offering, this great, amazing gift that I'm going to give of my very own life. And although we might like to think about Jesus as Lord, as the mighty and victorious King riding in, having conquered all his foes, where we see the heart of who Jesus is as Lord is there on the cross. There on the cross, where Jesus was weak, where Jesus was rejected, where Jesus seemed defeated. He looked like anything but a Lord there in that moment. He was ridiculed and derided, and yet there on the cross is where we see him as Lord most, giving of his very life, knowing that no, though we didn't deserve it, it was the only way. That this is exactly what we needed, and out of his great love, he would give of his very own life that you and I might be forgiven and set free. Here we see the true heart of Jesus as Lord, the suffering servant giving of himself that you and I might be set free. So at the heart of us recognizing Jesus as Lord, of following him as Lord, it starts with just receiving from him day in and day out, not just once, but realizing each and every day we need to receive mercy and grace from our God, because without him, without his mercy and grace and forgiveness, we would be lost. We cannot do without his mercy and forgiveness and grace. We are completely reliant upon him serving us. Jesus goes on after supper, after he's washed all the disciples' feet, he comes back to his place and he comes to bring it all together. He says, do you guys understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. Once again, he's showing them, what does it mean for him to be Lord? At the heart of it is that he is one who has come to serve and give his very life for them. But he goes on and says, what does this mean for you all as my followers? He says, if I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example. I've given you a pattern. I've given you something to follow, to look at and to follow after, that you also should do just as I have done to you. Jesus says, if you're going to declare, if you're going to receive me as Lord, if you're going to follow me as Lord, you have to first recognize and receive this act of service I have to give to you. But then you're called to follow after me, to having received this radical, amazing love and service to you, that you would go and do the same to those that I place before you each and every day. Because in that way, they will get to experience my love and grace and mercy through you. In that way, they too might come to know and receive this gift of life. See, what Jesus says is that because sacrificial service defines him as Lord, well, sacrificial service should define his followers as well. That's what people should know Jesus' followers for, is sacrificial service. Kindness, radical kindness and service, love, going out of their way to meet the needs of others and show the love of Jesus to them. So the question we all have to ask is, does it? Is that what defines us collectively as followers of Jesus? And people think of Jesus, followers of Christians, do they think of people who are radically and always willing and ready to serve and to give? Or even about you and me, thinking about my own life. If you were to be in a conversation with someone and they asked about, you know, Pastor Mark came up in a conversation, would they say that about me? I think it's good for us to reflect on that. You know, we all fall short of this, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't keep seeking to grow and learn in this, because this is what our God has called us to. And once again, this flows from realizing and grasping and receiving in its fullness that our God has already radically served and met our greatest need, and he has promised to meet all of our needs. And so we can be free and safe and secure. We can go and serve knowing that our God is for us and with us, and he will not leave our side. Our God has washed us clean, and as he has served us in this radical way, we too are to go and bring his forgiveness and new life, to wash the feet of those he places before us. And, you know, you don't have to actually go and literally wash people's feet, though if you want to do that, that is an impactful way to show care and kindness. But there's many other ways, right? Just being with someone in the midst of their pain and sorrow, that communicates the love of Jesus in a radical way. Time is our most limited resource. When we give of our time to other people, that is sacrificial service. Maybe it's meeting whatever needs people have, but our God is calling us into this day in, day out, that we would recognize him as Lord by receiving from him and recognizing our desperate need for his forgiveness and mercy, but then also going and seeking to serve in the same way. That in doing that, in acting and serving others sacrificially, that we declare that Jesus is Lord of our life. It is an act of worship, as we said on that serve day. The service, or that worship didn't end when that service did. As we went out and served our community in the love of Jesus, that was an act of worship. That is an honorable act for our God. May we not just serve when it's convenient and easy and comfortable, but may we serve in a sacrificial way, a way that costs us something. And may our God use that to impact the lives of those around us, that they too might come to know of his great love, and that his kingdom might be built in this place, in our neighborhoods, in our workplaces, in our community, and beyond. What a privilege to be a part of that, friends. May God embolden, empower you to lean into that each and every day. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for being a Lord who is defined by radical sacrificial service, because, Lord, though we didn't deserve it, we desperately needed it. You accomplished for us what we could not do for ourselves, and we thank you and praise you for that. Help us never to lose sight of that. How amazing that gift is. May it be at the core of who we know you as and how we recognize you as Lord, that each and every day that we would recognize without you, we would be lost. That we would thank you for your forgiveness and mercy and receive it anew each and every day. And may that lead us then, Lord, to go and to serve as you have served us in a way that the world looks at and says, what are they doing? Why would they do that? And that you would open up a door for us to share of why we do that. Because you are Lord and Savior, because you have served us in a radical way, well, it's our way of honoring you to go and serve others in your name. It's a way to love them as you have loved us. Lord, empower us by your Spirit. We pray this in your mighty and powerful name. Amen.
Worship with our hands out and praise you through that suffering that you've shown us.
Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Children, and their children, may his favor be upon you.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you, everything you. He is with you, He is with you.
Something uncomfortable. It's going to be okay. I promise it'll be okay. Could we stand and face each other, this side facing this way, this side facing this way? And could we sing that last, or that verse just one more time? We're singing the blessing to each other. You know, this is an incredible thing. It's not just the pastor that can speak the blessing, right? It's the church singing the blessing to one another. And that's what that last song was. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to sing the blessing to each other. Hey, people on this side, if you can make eye contact with one person on this side, you make eye contact with people on this side, we're going to sing that song once. Not the whole song. We're not going to sing the whole song.
Let's sing it together, folks. Ready?
Just the first verse.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. We keep singing it. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you.
this world singing the blessing to each other. May we go out and be a blessing to one another, loving each other and caring for one another. May we go out and live our lives as a blessing to the world around us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
And stop at the hunt table.
Oh, yeah. Go sign up for your hunt.